Welcome. This is a demonstration on groups and promoting growth within a group setting. I'm Sam Gladding, and I'll introduce let our members of our group introduce themselves in just a moment. In fact, let's let that moment be now.
All right. I'm Nathaniel Ivers. I'm an assistant professor at Wake Forest University.
I'm Jose Vialda. I'm an associate professor at Wake Forest.
I'm Marlene Estenson. I'm here in town at Cincinnati Christian University.
I'm Brian Calhoun. I'm an instructor at Wake Forest University.
I'm Pamela Carr. I'm program manager at Guess Where, Wake Forest University. Yeah.
So as you can tell, this group is loaded. a lot of Wake Forest, but we have one outlier here in Marlene who's never met the people at Wake Forest before. This is unrehearsed, so we will see what develops. We want to allow time for questions and process toward the end. So if you're wondering, will you get to ask a question? If you want to, you will. We'll allow about 20 minutes for that. And I will repeat your questions just for the sake of clarity. Okay? I want to preface what we're going to do today with just a few remarks. Basically, I really believe in the process of group and the power of group. I used not to, and I will tell you my transformation and epiphany in regard to this. Once upon a time, I was teaching at a community college. I thought that the way you taught was that you had notes and that you lectured and that students would absorb and get your material through osmosis, and they would think, what a great professor. However, I realized that my students were not exactly engaged with me. And one night this occurred to me. I must confess I have these dreams at times, and they usually enlighten me. And this dream was a particularly powerful dream, as I realized that the class I had taught the day before had gone flat as a pancake without any yeast. And so what happened in the dream was this, that I was standing in front of the class as usual, but I decided that I would get on the desk where I usually taught, and that I would have basically the students line up. And so the students would line up. I would be on top like this. And Nate, if you would come over for just a moment.
In back of you?
Yeah, students would line up, and they would come by just like ducks in a shooting gallery. Except when they got to me, they would raise their heads, open their mouths. I would put my notes on their right across their mouths, and then I had a ramrod, and I would just put it right down their gullet, and they would absorb it that way. So after that, I started using groups, and so that's my story of why groups, I think, are so important. There's a better learning experience many times than just through lecturing. When we look at groups, I think we basically look at four types of groups, and you're aware of that. We look at task groups, we look at educational groups, we look at counseling groups, and we look at therapy groups. This particular group we're going to do today is more of a counseling group where those who are involved are working on areas in their lives that they want to improve. I think also we look at, we look at stages in groups. We look at forming, storming, norming, performing, and adjourning, or mourning. Anything that ends with the ing what kind of sound we look at that. And this particular group is going to be one that's in the performing stage because we don't have time to do otherwise. Again, when we look at groups, there's some things that I think we need to look at. And one is, what techniques are we going to use? What processes are we going to use? And what we hope to accomplish in the group. There needs to be a goal at the end where we do something, and so that we just don't talk. If you remember the lyrics from the rock group Meatloaf, they have a little lyric that says, "Baby, we could talk all night, but that ain't getting us nowhere." We want to get somewhere, or in the words of Michael Jackson in The Wiz, we want to ease on down the road of life. So there are a lot of things we can do. I've basically listed about 108 techniques that can be used in groups. We won't use but 107 of those today. Actually, we won't use that many. We'll probably use a baker's dozen, around 13. So things that I would say that you might want to look for within the group are things like the executive function that I would have as the group leader, that is to set up the group and to get it moving and going. Caring, that there is care that goes on within the group. There is encouragement by the group, of other group members, and certainly by me. There would be certainly empathy and goal setting. Kind of a here and now focus. Things can happen there and then, but we want to work here and now because that gets us to there and then and somewhere else. Joining with the group, linking group members with one another. These are things that I think you know, but I just want to remind you of, and things that I hope to accomplish today. Making the rounds, making sure that everybody has some air time. If people don't have air time, they just kind of let the air out some way or another through either being passive or passive aggressive. I'm from North Carolina, and we always say you don't have to be Southern to be passive aggressive, but it helps. So, a couple of other things reflecting of feeling, reflecting of content. Silence. Silence is sometimes a very powerful thing, and we don't need to always be jumping in and trying to dictate what happens. And summarizing, of course, which we'll do at the end, and using the power of the group itself rather than the group being dependent just on me as the leader. So that's more than a baker's dozen, but you get a bonus for just being here. Last thing I would say is that I think all groups have a personality. There's a power in a group. And so you can hear the group almost breathing. It's an entity. I mean, you can almost hear it breathe. I don't think any of these people will be breathing that way, but it has a personality, and I want to respect that personality that is the group. Last thing I would say is that I will try to model what I hope the group will do, and that is, as the group leader, I always think it's important, in fact I think the literature shows it's important, that when you ask someone to do something, you do it yourself first, rather than saying, "Pamela, be spontaneous." I would try to be spontaneous myself. Obviously you can't just be spontaneous. Well, maybe you can, but I won't ask people to do something that I don't do first. So I will not let inappropriate behavior continue. I will try to model behavior. And sometimes I will use hand signals if needed. Using our whole body, our whole selves in a group can really make a difference in how the group functions. So it's not just verbal. It's sometimes it's behavioral and obviously cognitive in terms of assessing what's going on in the group. So this group is a growth group, a counseling group, a group that's working on areas that they want to improve in their lives. And we will begin the group, and then we will allow some time after we've done things for you to ask questions and to process the group. There won't be anything that will be kind of hocus pocus in terms of I'm going to just pull out a trick here and throw it into the group. Rather, I will use group research, evidence-based research, that says this is what you do in such a group. And I'm going to aim for the positive because we know that it's usually a 5-to-1 kind of ratio of people knowing things that are negative in their lives, and growth comes through not only eliminating the negative but emphasizing the positive. So with that, we will begin, and if I have my back to some of you, please forgive me, but you'll get to see the beautiful people this way, and those of you unfortunate enough in this area, you get to see me. We're here today. We've been meeting before, and we've been looking at those things that we want to accomplish in our lives. And so one of those things that I want to do this morning as we kind of go around is to look with you at activities and events that have happened in your life just recently that have been significant or positive, and then we will get into areas that we want to work on as individuals. And not that everybody will work on everything today, but hopefully the uniqueness of something you have may strike someone else as something they'd like to have and like to be working on. We'll also be helping each other in regard to growth. So let's begin in terms of some airtime with something that's happened significant or positive in your life this week, and I'd like for you to kind of scale it from 1 to 10 of how good it's been for you. So I'll start, and basically my wife would not believe this because I have very bland taste, but I had a great meal last night with some friends, and it was probably one of the top 10 meals I've ever had in my life, and so I would, and the friends were good, and the wine was great. So I would rate that about an 8 or 9 because it was really just a fun and significant time. And why don't we go this way, Pamela?
Okay. Well, a week ago today, I was finishing the last day of a week in St. Lucia, where I was pampered totally, and I didn't even turn my phone on, much less try to check the internet for a week. Now that was a 10. I can't even imagine how I could have improved on that except to have figured out how to stay there.
Gotcha. Brian?
I would say the event that was really exciting this week, on Tuesday I won a call-in show for some concert tickets. Oh, wow. So I was the 20th caller, I got in, I'm really excited about it, so I'd rate that about an 8.
About an 8. Concert tickets.
Yes, exciting.
Good.
I went to Columbus to visit a friend that I haven't seen in a long time. And so I got to spend the night there and just catch up with her. And I would say that was a good 9.
Mm,
it was
great.
Really enjoyable.
Yeah, I would say last week I spent some time with my wife in Dallas. We hadn't been out without our kids for a long time. And so we spent about 4 or 5 days in Dallas at a conference, and it was good just to spend time, the two of us. We missed our kids, but not that much. And that was about an 11.
Mine's kid-related as well. I have 4 children, and my youngest is 11 months, and you know, she's gone in stages of how she's sleeping, but for the past 2 months, she's been waking up 2 or 3 times a night. It's just, usually our kids haven't done that, but she did. But last week, she started sleeping completely through the night, and so that's helping out a lot with all aspects of my life. But I would call it kind of a 7 at this point, because I'm still catching up on that sleep.
That'll take you several years. Yeah. Well, good. Everybody's had a chance to say a little something and to think of something that's been good in your life. I'm wondering what you might want to work on today. Again, I know that everyone's coming from a different place, but who would like to work on something today? And again, we can do a go-round and see if there's something that's in common. So, in this case, I will not lead.
Anyway. Well, I am a little worried in advance because after a week off, I had 2 days in the office and then I came here. So I know what's waiting for me on Monday, and it's totally overwhelming, and it's all important, and I'm not sure. Yeah, I'm just worried in advance.
Okay.
But I know I don't work really productively when I'm that worried in advance.
Right. Okay. So, being able to put it in perspective and to work through it and not to worry so much about it.
Right.
I think the thing I want to work on is assertiveness. I just want to be more assertive at work. There are meetings that I go to, and I just want to have my voice heard, and I'm having trouble doing that, getting that confidence, I guess.
Okay. So finding your voice and finding your confidence to express your voice.
Yes.
Okay. Marlene?
I just, you know, finished my dissertation, as you know, and so I feel like I'm engaging with my family again at a different level because I've been in a certain role for the last 3 years with them, and while I've made a point to be there, it's been different, and now I'd like to really, I'm back in the family, and I want to make sure especially my teenage daughters feel my presence even more than before, and yet honored at the fact that they're 16 and independent.
Mm. Mm-hmm. So re-entering family and connecting, reconnecting.
Yeah, and mine is family related as well. Just striking a bit of a balance between work and home. And we all talk a little bit about that sometimes, about how hard it is to do that balancing. Last weekend was great, and part of what I'm stuck with is how do I recreate that on a regular basis?
Right.
Because it's all work and all kids all the time, which leaves little time for my wife and I.
Right.
Yeah.
Finding that space for you and your wife, as well as doing your work
and being a dad.
Yeah, and being a dad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mine's very similar in nature. I have similar constraints. Lots of work opportunities that are out there, and then finding just individual time. After the neuroscience presentation, I realized that I need to do a little bit more exercising. Finding time for that.
Okay. Well, you know, humor will help you do that. But, again, finding time for you as well as for everything else that is on your plate.
Right.
Okay. So who would like to delve deeper into an area that you're concerned about?
Well, I will. Because one thing I realized is that I totally forgot about everything outside of work. I'm focused totally on, you know, we connected very well with my husband while we were away for a week together, and now I'm away again. And when I come back, I'm likely to push everything aside full speed ahead without remembering exercise or any sort of balance.
Right.
And because that's probably a pattern. Here we go. All right, everything out of the way. Yeah. List galore and go.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Frenzied.
Yeah, I agree too. It's I think we do a good job of compartmentalizing things, mm-hmm. and every now and again, when you don't do that, you get overwhelmed. You know, and so in your case, it's what do I do now, kind of to get it all back together. The same thing with happens too. It's how do you balance that out, and how do you keep from not focusing on one thing at a time? Yeah.
And you mentioned this earlier, and I have, I think it resonates with my own experiences. But when I have a lot to do, and my list of things is this big, when I get into work, I'm the least productive ever. That's when I check my emails 100 times. I have so much to do that I don't know where to start. And that can make it difficult. And then I tell myself, well, I can have fun after I get these things done, which also makes me less productive, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It does sound like that's in common with all of us in many ways. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It sounds like it is, that the people really are trying to strike a balance between the work and the other relationships in life without one tipping the scale this way or that way. And in your case, and I think I hear it from Nate and Jose and Marlene and Brian to an extent too, that's really important to be able to create that balance. So let me ask, and let's use the power of the group that's here. Mm-hmm. How have you found ways to do that in the past? What has worked for you mm-hmm. in not letting one dominate the other and outweigh it?
For me, it was some years ago, but I actually had to schedule the fun event so that it was on the schedule, and I was committed to someone else, so I couldn't just put it aside because it was my own thing. But it was actually kind of, I'm taking ownership of this, but it was actually my wife who signed me up for a tennis league. And in being part of that league, I had to play tennis because it was scheduled, and then I found myself a whole lot more productive. But I just have to remind myself of that because I... just going out and setting up these things on my own sometimes feels like, well, if I do this, then I won't have time for that.
Right. But maybe that connects a little with what Brian was saying about being assertive in your life, and even though yours was a little different than that about being assertive in meetings, it's maybe being assertive with yourself mm-hmm. and making putting it on the schedule mm-hmm. So that you will do it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What else has worked for people?
I had two thoughts. One is that I, in the past, have always tried to make a list of my priorities, you know, and my relationships are higher than my work, and try to keep that close to me and look at it regularly. That's been helpful to me. And the other thing is to be proactive. I've at times looked at just telling those around me who I know it's going to affect, like I did do this in the last 3 years, and say, this is what I'm doing, do we all know about it, and we're all on board with it, and this is what it's going to mean and look like. But there will be an end, and communicate that regularly. And that I think that was helpful.
Sounds like, I mean, it's really important to be able to say to yourself, temporarily, this may have to be
right.
Really, really paid attention to.
Right.
But there will be a time where I can get more balanced.
Right, with your project. Mm-hmm.
And again, calling in allies.
Right.
Using others to mm-hmm. remind you, hey, this is what I'm going to do.
And promising not to cut their heads off when they say it.
I don't think we went there about cutting their heads off, but appreciating them, that they are letting us know that there's someplace we want to go and that it does have an end as well as a meaning in for the present.
One of the things that you said was telling yourself. So I engage a bit in self-talk and trying to get rid of some of those defeating thoughts that I have sometimes. So with this inability to strike a balance, guilt comes up, and guilt just kind of festers. And so what I try to do to balance it out is don't be so hard on yourself. You don't beat yourself up about it. If you can't find that balance, it's okay. Otherwise, the guilt just builds up, So I've worked a lot on self-talk, and that's a bit of a CBT approach, but it works for me, just kind of telling myself it's going to be okay. Sometimes it has to happen that way, and it is what it is. Otherwise, I end up feeling guilty, and I'm not balanced, and that's really, really bad.
Wow. So basically, talking to yourself in a very positive way, this is what I need to do, this is what I can do.
Right, right.
And while I hate to take, you know, it's like Sunday, I could work all day Sunday to get ready to make it easier for myself on Monday, maybe taking some time to get the exercise figured out would be helpful. And some time to figure out, to remind myself the self-talk I always tell other people, you can't do it all in one day. You cannot do it all in one day. Just focus on what's important. And then when something else comes up, make a decision. Is this more important than what I had decided was important? And at least have a list, even if you throw it on the floor. So I think getting a little planned would help me. Right now I have none. I've been too off.
And I think exercise is really important. I make 3 days my exercise days during the week. I think it's just good to be regimented. So you're talking about Sunday being a day of exercise.
Right. Yeah. And usually I'm lucky enough that we have a dog. And I think that if you have a dog, you will go on walks more in the morning because you can't say no to that face. And I was thinking, well, I probably won't do any of my walking or my exercise this week because I need to get in there and get going, but I'll rethink that strategy.
Right.
Even if I'm there at 9, I'll probably be a better 9 than an early worried 8, maybe.
Right.
I find, too, that if you, you know, for me, if I remind myself during the day that I'm not going to deprive myself for a whole week if I have a project like you're talking about, or I will be very frustrated. So like you're saying, taking the walk or the things that you want to do, make sure that you get them in. But even just like using my special coffee cup in the morning, or taking 2 minutes to read a comic or something that I'm going to enjoy, but to consciously choose to make it a 9.
I can still do my Sudoku?
Yeah, exactly. I do them all the time. I find that's helpful to me, so that I'm not waiting a week to do that.
So giving yourself permission to do some things, prioritizing is one thing I think you mentioned but didn't say the word.
Right.
And again, realizing that it can't all be done in the snap of your fingers. That walking is important. Sudoku, well, okay. somewhat important for just having a little recreation in your life.
Right.
Yeah.
Brian, can I, you said you exercise 3 days a week. Mm-hmm. You set the time aside. Can you tell me a little bit more?
Well, I think it's just, I kind of play off your schedule, making a schedule or making a day. Uh-huh. I just say to myself, I'm going to take 3 days, I'm going to work out on those 3 days, and make that the minimum. Now, if I go over 3, it's good, and it helps with the balance of the stress in the workplace.
Do you put it on your calendar like he?
I do put it on my calendar, and I put it on the fridge. I actually put the calendar on the fridge, and I can say that Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I'm going to run. I'm going to run for 20 minutes. And if I go over that, it's great. But, yeah, just making that schedule. I think that's what you mentioned as well, making a day.
Seems to, even if you put your own appointment on there, it seems to make you do it, doesn't it? More. Oh, well. But then you have to look ahead to see if it's going to rain that day or not.
That's right. Yeah. But you try to make up for it. So if it rains on Wednesday, you go on Thursday.
All right, gotcha. Flexibility.
Flexibility.
Does that help?
Yeah, that does help. You answered both of my questions. And one was, how do you do that and what do you do? Mm-hmm. And it sounds like running is what you do. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So if I can summarize some, what we've come up with as a group has been some self-talk, some writing out and prioritizing what it is you want to do, some reminders and having some allies, with friends and family, who can help you and reinforce you in what you want to do. What else am I leaving out? that you've said.
To have a wife that schedules it for you.
To have a wife that schedules it for you. That will be good. Or a significant other, a main squeeze of some type of partner. Yeah, who, again, can help you do that. And self-talk, reminding, again, yourself, this is what I'm going to do. But Pamela, coming back to you, how does, and realizing these things don't happen in one day, that you can't make up for everything in one day, and that you need some recreation along the way, as well as work and other things that you're planning. Tell us how this resonates with you.
Well, it kind of helps me put things a little more in perspective. I do feel calmer, honestly and truly. Maybe my shoulders quit being like this and they're more like that.
Okay.
So, thank you. It's kind of like the book Everything You Learned in Kindergarten, but you know, I know all these things. I just had kind of forgotten about them.
Right. So you feel physically more relaxed mentally?
Yeah, it's not quite spinning as fast, no.
Okay.
It's got a plan.
Okay. And so what will happen when you go back?
I think that a plane ride of a couple of hours is a pretty good opportunity to take my day timer and try to think about when could I exercise, even though I won't be able to look up the weather.
Okay.
And maybe just come up with a couple of the most important, time-wise. I mean, that have to be done at a certain time.
Okay.
And try to resolve to focus on those on Monday, to remember that I just went to a Covey course on five choices, and which it had me really take a look at my overall purposes in life that included personals, and read those again and try to remind myself what's important in the long run, and that the activities I'm choosing support those goals I wrote for myself. I haven't looked at that again since I wrote it. I think that would help me to go back again and try to make a plan.
Okay. So one of the things I like to do when thinking about moving from here and now into the future is kind of like they do in Hollywood, not like they do in Hollywood in terms of their lifestyles, but what they do in Hollywood in regard to making films. So it's kind of like scene one, scene two, scene three. How do you see yourself? What are some ways that you could play out your life in regard to what you do? And so scene one would be, or production one would be, what would you do?
Look at the week as a whole.
Okay.
And try to spread out the big rocks.
Okay.
The big rocks are the big things I have to do, not the 20 million, no telling how many emails are going to be sitting there.
Right.
Eek.
Okay. Scene two.
Schedule whether I'm going to do weights or walk in the mornings so that I can get back on that track.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Scene three, this will be over the top, but I'll probably go ahead and make my typical menu plan for the week so that when I get home I know what I want to buy from the grocery store and I can stop peeking out, get back on the healthier choice plan.
Okay. So you've got at least three choices.
Right.
And I think when we look at growth in personally and in a group, it's always good to have more than one choice. And if you can have two, if you can have three, if you can have four, then you have some options. Mm-hmm. And if you have choices, you can make changes. But if you don't have choices, you won't have those abilities to make many changes. So are you fine with what we've done?
Thanks.
Okay. We have time for another, if somebody would like to.
Brian? I noticed something in myself. Nate had to really draw me out to flesh out my idea. I just didn't feel like I was assertive enough in helping Pamela with her kind of setting up the calendar for athletic event or kind of a stress reliever. Mm-hmm. I just want to work on that, I guess. I thank Nate for doing that, okay. Just kind of helping me flesh out my answer. But I do want to work on that assertiveness piece, that I do have some good ideas that I could help Pamela with, but I just kind of wait too long.
So do you want to work on that assertiveness piece now?
I would, if the group would. Yeah.
How's the group? I see heads nodding affirmatively. Well, let's talk about exactly what you'd like to work on, Brian.
I think I would want to work on fleshing out ideas. I think I could help you out a lot more in group if I just articulate better and think about what's important to you and not be afraid to say it. And I think that's something that I just need to work on.
So what keeps you from saying what you'd like to say?
I think I'm afraid that when I say it, people might judge me that I'm not saying the right thing, or that what I have to say isn't important. So, yeah.
Okay, and it's more with Pamela than anyone else?
I think it's just in my whole, life. It's just I do have important things to say. I just want to have that confidence to be able to say it and to put it out there.
Okay.
That's interesting, because I found myself wanting to pull you out. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's my personality, but because you were so quiet, I wanted to say I was worried about him, and I was hoping we would have time to go back to, we have more in common with the other things that we were talking about than your assertiveness issue.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So how are you feeling about the assertiveness issue? And I wonder if other people around you find that too, that they have to pull you out or want to pull you out because mm-hmm. of your quietness. Because I think you have a lot of good things to say, probably. Mm-hmm. And I don't know you that well, but I would mm-hmm. imagine so.
Mm-hmm. I feel like I am quiet, and I was thankful that Nate kind of pulled the answer out of me. I think I could have said more during my time. But, yeah, thank you for saying that.
So Nate helped pull things out.
Most definitely. It was things that were going on, thoughts of what I could, give to Pamela. And he really did notice that, and I appreciate that about this group, that he did do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let's try an experiment or an experience. Mm-hmm. So, Nate, would you be willing to pull things out of Brian?
I'll give it a try.
Okay. Okay. Well, let's try it. If you'd maybe stand up and we'll have the group observe, and I'll just kind of be the coach here. So, Brian, if you would let Nate know what you'd like for him to pull out, maybe that would be helpful. You've got all these things here. Which one do you want him to pull out?
Well, just things that I do to relieve stress and get more work-life balance. Okay. That works for me.
Okay. So do I need to tell the group?
How would you pull that out?
How would I pull it? Well, I would ask for specifics.
Okay.
Can you tell me specifically what you're doing? And how that's helpful.
Well, I noticed that she talked about the Franklin Covey, the scheduling. I also have done the Franklin Covey course and know about what you do to kind of prioritize projects, and it relieves stress. Mm-hmm. Yet I didn't feel confident enough to tell her in the moment.
How has it helped you?
It's helped me to let her know that I share that kind of scheduling thing, and then we could talk about it in group and help her more with her work-life balance.
Right. And anything specific about the Franklin Covey scheduling that has been beneficial?
It relieves my anxiousness, and I think it would do the same thing for you, Pamela, just to know that I've done it and I can show you what I do.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So, I appreciate you kind of pulling that out of me. So,
okay. So if it were a box or something and there were tools in that box, what tools would you want?
Well, I'd hand my Franklin Covey planner to Nate here to look at for himself as well. He mentioned he wanted to schedule time as well. I think all of us in the group have that.
Yeah.
We need to schedule and make priorities in our life. Jose with his wife, Marlene, you mentioned you wanted to schedule more time, and Pamela, that was her main issue, so definitely could do that.
So it's not just Nate pulling something out of you, you're giving something to him also, that and to Jose and to Marlene and to Pamela that you have.
Most definitely, and it's useful, and I want to share that with the group and to Nate. So.
And is there one or two specifics that you could give him?
I would say just set everything, write it down. We mentioned Pamela doing Sudoku. I take about 10 minutes in the day, and that's what I'd give to you. I say, at the beginning of the day, I do 10 minutes where I just sit and work on my schedule, and then I work on my priorities.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the piece I would get. It's more information-based.
So here's something I'd like for you to do. So, Nate, if you could hold out your hands like that, and Brian, if you could give him that, and then, Nate, you can set it there.
Wait.
Too anxious.
Okay.
So what I'd like to do, sometimes when we are in a group, we talk about things that are happening, but we don't kind of get it into the marrow of our bones, and we don't get it into behaviors. So an enactment where you actually give him these things that you've talked about, he receives them, he can set them down, and you can give him one or two more, depending on how many you have.
Mm-hmm.
He's helped you, now you're helping him.
Right. So this is just the knowledge that I have, that what works for me, and just give it to him?
Yes.
Okay.
But say it.
Okay.
It's like, you know.
This is my scheduling. This helps me with work-life balance.
But okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Specificity.
Okay.
So, yeah, he's good. So, being specific into terms of what you're giving him, and you can give him small gifts.
Okay.
You know, screwdrivers is helpful as a hammer sometimes.
Okay.
And so you can give him small gifts, and again, he can receive them.
Okay. Well, this is going to help you with stress. Would that be a good thing for him? He mentioned
planner.
Working out more, or a planner.
A planner.
A planner to work out.
Nate or Nathaniel, I'm giving you a planner.
Okay. Nate, I'm giving you a planner.
Thank you.
Okay. What else would you like to give me?
I need more.
You need more? I will give you my watch.
Some time. Okay.
I will give you different colored markers to prioritize in your planner.
I need those too. That's good.
Thank you.
All right. I will give you running shoes to do more athletic events and grow that mind.
I don't have any more room on my
chair. So, have I given him enough, or do I need to give him more?
Do you have more to give him?
I always, that's the problem. I have more to give, but I don't know when to.
It's okay to keep giving. He looks like he can take it.
Okay.
And could use it.
Yeah. I have a picture that helps with my mindfulness that will help when you are doing your planner, just to be mindful of putting your schedule together. It's a big picture.
Okay.
But it's a very peaceful scene. That's what I have to give.
That's what you have to give him.
Thank you.
And since giving is always a two-way street, he's mentioned things that you've given him in terms of reminders. Do you have anything else that you would like to give Brian?
Well, I think the only thing I would like to give you is just the, I don't know, that confidence to just give, just to be specific. So here's some specificity right here for you.
Thank you.
And you said, and some confidence.
Yes.
So, how does confidence look?
I think it looks like what Pamela did, from this to that.
Okay, so we're all from Missouri here, if you can show us.
Say.
Yeah.
I think it's just being open, opening up.
Okay.
Yeah.
So,
Oh.
And once you receive it now, how do you look in terms of confidence?
Well, my back is more arched, and I feel a little more confident, yes, because of it.
Okay.
It's just good to have that visual and to receive it from Nate and to see it in Pamela and be able to know that I can have that same feeling, the same confidence.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Does that resonate with you in terms of what?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Everybody?
That's great.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you've each given and received. This sounds like a marriage ceremony, but it's not. But yeah, it's a friendship, and it's a a building block in terms of something that you want to do. Again, it's not just in our minds or in our voice, but it's in our behavior as well, and in our feeling. And let me just ask both of you, what do you feel at this point?
Well, I literally feel like a weight has been taken off my shoulders just to be able to talk and share with Nate and give him those gifts. It feels good. I do feel more confident. I feel my back is a little more arched than when we started group.
Okay. Sure. Uh-huh. So you feel it in your body.
Most definitely.
Okay. Nate?
Well, I like what Brian gave me in particular. I liked what he said about taking 10 minutes every day. I know Brian a little, and I know he's highly productive, gets a lot done, has a lot on his plate. And one of my issues sometimes is if I take 10 minutes to plan, I lose 10 minutes to work.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, but again, I think if I give myself that time, I can be more productive as well. And so I'm taking that with me, his modeling as well as his ideas, I think are really helpful. And so I think what I'm feeling is energy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Great.
Energy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Good. So with Pamela and with Brian, we've got bodies that are a little bit different in terms of feeling a weight off your shoulder, I think you said, mm-hmm. and feeling your back arched a little better and more confident there. Mm-hmm. And with Nathaniel or Nate, which we'll call him both.
fine.
Yeah. feeling energized.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the feeling inside, that I've got some energy that I didn't have before.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Good. What else as we're moving in this group? We probably have time for one more person to do some work.
I just wanted to say I also got something out of watching the two of you do that, because you came up with, you know, shared the idea of a picture.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, I can use that too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I like the picture idea.
It is very peaceful just to look and just have something that's going to, you know, set your mind at ease while you're doing things. Yeah.
So thank you.
You're welcome.
And the picture you have, Marlene?
Well, I like the peaceful scene. Mm-hmm. I like that always. But a picture of my daughters right now would be one I would use in terms of, again, engaging back in my family. Would be a way to remind myself every day, priority. What am I doing today that does that?
Okay.
I would like that particularly.
Okay, so you can image that picture,
yes.
And what does that do for you in terms of a feeling,
mm-hmm.
Or a behavior?
Mm-hmm. Well, I have twin 16-year-olds, so one picture in particular that came to my mind immediately was one where they were dressed for Halloween as clowns,
mm-hmm.
and it's just one of my favorite pictures of them,
mm-hmm.
and to have that there, just a happy feeling, it's just a positive, satisfying, peaceful feeling of nurturance or something.
Okay.
For me.
So having that picture gives you a feeling of nurturance, and that leads to
more balance, more awareness of my priorities.
Okay.
And that's peaceful. So
okay.
I have a balance that we were talking about before.
Right. Right.
Okay.
For me.
Okay. So mm-hmm. that's a good.
That's a good thing.
Good gift you've received,
right.
and Brian gave it to you.
Right.
Do you want to hand off?
Thank you.
Welcome.
And I know sometimes it may feel just a little schmaltzy to be doing that, but again, if you have like a ceremony or a ritual, then you remember it much better, and it becomes much more a part of you than it does if you just say it.
And just because it's schmaltzy doesn't mean it doesn't mean anything. Right. I mean, right. One of the things that I've liked about what happened here today was it's tangible. You know, you were talking about sneakers and dry eraser, but when just you can see that, and that's a lot better than just talking about some of these more esoteric things. What is balance? I don't know what balance is, but when you talk about a picture of your girls, I can see that. Yeah, so that's been helpful. Schmaltzy or not, there is something that resonates when you can do something. Yeah, I like that.
I have a gift I'd like to give Jose.
What?
What you were talking about is how wonderful it was to have time with just your wife only, and that you have three children, and the youngest is?
One. Right.
And how hard that is to connect like you just were able to do. And so my gift would be an idea that we used all through our marriage when our children were younger, is that if there's somebody who can keep them, we tried to have a date. And that date was on Friday night. And that Friday night was not to be accepted any offers anywhere else. We just went out together by ourselves and had dinner.
Right.
And somebody kept our, from 1 year old up, and even he knew it was our date night. But if there was a way to give you the gift of thinking about the date night,
you can get
you
up
have
and give
a date.
It.
Got it.
And here's your calendar. It doesn't have to be Friday. But it's something that's really neat about deliberately making that
right.
time.
Right. Thanks, Pamela. Thank you. Yeah.
And again, the feeling that you might have?
Well, the feeling is that's a really good idea and that needs to get done. So it's almost like commitment. So the feeling I have is determination to do something about that, to not just say that's a good idea, but to go back, schedule it in, and do it. So my feeling is more perseverance, let's do this. Yeah.
Okay. So kind of a resolve.
Yeah. Better word, resolve.
Well, I'm trying to reflect what you're saying. And that, again, you feel a little,
better.
Better.
Yeah.
Okay.
Better. Yeah. For sure.
I didn't want to put words in your mouth. But yeah, so you feel better.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What else? We have about 5 minutes. I always want to make sure that you know when we're going to end. What else might there be that you would want to either give someone or that you want to make sure that you get a voice on before we end this group?
I noticed Jose re-gifted to Nate.
Well, he took it.
He took it.
Re-gifting and taking.
It's
a fine line.
Can we share the gifts with the whole group? Because I think
sure.
I'd like to have a picture and a date night and all that with my wife. So I mean, yeah. Okay, is that possible?
Sure.
Okay.
So tell him what you're giving, and
okay. And on that planner, date night.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And do you want to give Marlene anything?
Would you like a date night too?
I would.
That'd be wonderful. That's great.
It would be very important.
Okay. Nathaniel, how many children do you have?
I have four, and I definitely took the date night. Thank you.
So there's no re-gifting here. You gave it direct. Yeah. Other things?
I want some of the calendar stuff.
You want the calendar stuff?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well,
you can share.
Okay.
You have more?
Here's the calendar.
Thank you.
Here are the running shoes.
Okay.
Here are the colored markers to put on your calendar.
Oh, I like colored markers.
And here are some post-it notes.
All right.
And here is a picture.
Thank you.
To look at when you're doing your scheduling.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So everybody's had a chance to say something and to work on something that's important for you. And it sounds like there's a lot of similarity, even though there's a uniqueness in each, and that the gifts that you've given one another have some meaning for you, and that they matter, and again that you have something that is transformed not only in your mind but somewhat in your resolve and in your behavior. Am I hearing that right?
Yes.
Okay. So as we wind up and let the audience process with us, I'm wondering, what are those things that you're taking away? Because there are always takeaways from groups. Otherwise, it's just an experience, and those type of experiences are soon forgotten. So what are you taking away? And we won't do a go-round as such, but we'll let it be as you want to speak.
I'm going to speak first because I feel like I have more confidence now.
Yay!
And yeah, the shoulders back that Nate gave to me from looking at you, I feel like I've received in this group.
Okay. So. Okay. And you can have more than one takeaway, but if that's
my main
takeaway. Your main takeaway.
That's really what I wanted to work
right.
on.
Right. Just want to make sure you know you can have
yes.
more than one.
Mm-hmm. I want to try to live in the moment. And enjoy my life in the moment. And for me, I was thinking it's just a gift to have this experience,
yeah.
you know, to get ideas and thoughts from all of you. It was a gift that I enjoyed in this last hour.
Mm-hmm. And my gift is clarity. Mm-hmm. Again, the notion that these things aren't as complicated as we make them out to be sometimes.
Yeah.
Set a date. Done. It's complicated because we have kids, but it doesn't mean that it can't be done. It's more of an excuse. So, clarity.
Just so, clarity.
Clarity is my word, yeah.
Okay.
Clarity.
My mind's energy. I've, for some time now, I've had the desire to improve my exercise regimen, but the desire has not translated into action. Mm-hmm. And so the energy is there, and some of the concrete ideas are there as well, which I hope to start incorporating.
Okay. So it's not like you're a wild horse, just running wild. You have the energy,
mm-hmm.
but you also have a direction.
Yes, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Good.
Yeah. I feel like I didn't, if you had said you were going to ask me about something I needed to work on, I was like, oh no, I have to make something up. But I didn't have to, and I really appreciate the help
mm-hmm.
That I got going back into daily life. So it's just another manic Monday.
So it won't be just another Monday that you have a plan.
That's right.
And you have,
will.
Again, some will, and you have some scenarios that you can either start this way or start that way or start that way. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And hopefully that kind of goes throughout the group in terms of realizing that you have options and how you exercise the options makes a difference in both how you behave and how you feel and what you think. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anything else from anyone? Well, let me say I've enjoyed working with you this morning. We didn't know exactly what would come about, but it does sound like a lot has come that's of a positive nature that you can build on, that you've given and received gifts, and that your feeling and your manner and your behavior and even your thoughts are different than they were initially. So why don't we close this, get some feedback from the audience. I'll repeat their questions, and if they want to address you specifically, then we'll feel free to go with that. Mm-hmm. So let me stop and applaud you for what you've done, and let me turn to the audience for a moment mm-hmm. and see questions, comments that you might have in regard to what you've seen us do here. How do you stop someone? This group did not do that. They were polite. but that's not every group member in every group. And so we have people who seem to just run on and on and on. How do you stop them and get them to focus? So let me tell you how I do that, and others may want to chip in and also give you some feedback on that. But one of the things I do is I use my body. I didn't use it that much here, but I will use it at times to give signals to people. So this is a universal sign that everyone knows in terms of, like, time out.
Yeah, show them back there.
And yeah, like this. Or if somebody's getting too close to someone, I might, you know, give them this kind of a signal, like, maybe not. But I think sometimes we think that one of the basic things we have to do in a group is to just use our voice. And I really do believe in using the body and letting people know ahead of time. Because, again, if they don't know, they may not respond. They may not respond anyway, and you may have to do more than what we're saying here. But letting them know that there may be some signals, guys, that I need for you to respect. And then asking them in a very constructive way, John or Jane, I hear you saying a lot, but I'm not sure what the essence of that is. Could you put that into two or three sentences and play with them in the sense that there is a playfulness. It's serious, but play is always serious in terms of learning something. So asking them to do that and letting it go from there in terms of fewer words. And let's see then if members of the group can tell you what they heard. That, and so use the power of the group. Sometimes, again, we think it's all on our shoulders as the group leader, but the group is very powerful, and this group, I think, did demonstrate that in terms of what they were doing. So sometimes, and let me repeat the question. So you have a girls' group and a boys' group. Girls' group's fine, they talk. I mean, and girls are great at doing this. Boys, I mean, I have three sons. They grunt. I can just tell you. Boys are grunters. Girls seem to find words for what they're doing. But so the boys aren't talking. So some of the things I do for a group, and it's mandatory that they be there. I'm hearing you say that. So some of the things I do to try to get the boys talking is I'll have a Nerf ball or something that we'll be passing around. And getting them warmed up. And one of the things I think that's important is to make sure people have a warm-up. So John, Jim, Troy, whoever the person is, if you give them a warm-up, like what would be your favorite food, and boys are into food. I wouldn't go, what's your favorite color? Because they're not. They know black, blue, green. That's it. but something that you know they have some interest, or what's your favorite sport, or whatever, to get them warmed up. And then sometimes you can actually do theme groups. So I think I heard you say that the boys are always wanting to talk about sex or something. So I mean that's great, but that's not where they need to be. So let's talk about how you can be more successful, or how you can put your best foot forward. And you can even have them again playing, which is your best foot, and what does that represent? And again, looking at the culture, look at the development of the boys. If they're concrete thinkers, you're not going to get them to say, oh, and this is what that represents. And culturally, again, we have to certainly respect that and be aware of that. But using themes, because they don't seem to be able to structure it for themselves. And there's some really good books here at the American Counseling Association Conference on favorite group techniques, and they're theme related. So that's where I'd go with that. I think a group, again, has a life of its own, and some groups don't live as long or as well. And I don't mean to be flippant in saying that, but I do think that some groups are going to run shallow and run short in regard to what they do. And I am convinced that not every group needs to go that deep, that again, developmentally, if people begin to feel safe, if they begin to trust, then the next time they're in a group, they may go a little deeper yet, and so letting it be that way, I think is fine, and realizing that as the group leader, I haven't failed the group, I've helped move them along, and the next time they're in another group, they may feel enough trust to go a little deeper, and I may not even see that as the leader. So one thing I want to do when I find that a person is saying the group ended on a negative note, or for me, I don't want to go back with those people, is basically saying, again, as I said to this group as we ended, what are your takeaways from that? So what would you want to do differently? Because you'll be the leader next time, or you'll be in a group next time. What would you want to take away, and what do you think you might do to make that different? I think anticipation is not just a word. It's a way that we begin to move in life and to realize I have some power, as Brian has found out, in terms of being assertive and anticipating some of the problems. And so it's when I was courting my wife, I would always think, okay, and I know she thought this more than I did, if she says this, I'll say this. And it's kind of silly, and it's amazing we've lasted 27 years. But anticipating what you might do to make it better. Most, and we know this from the research, that people know five negatives to every positive in their lives, and that seems to show up almost every research study, approximately that ratio. So it'd be easier for them to tell me a negative, and it'd be easier for us to work on a negative. Alan Ivey and Mary Ivey this morning, when they were talking at the ACA opening session, talked about building on the positives rather than working on the problems. And I think that's, even though we didn't coordinate our sessions, I do think that it makes the group more alive, it makes it more constructive. And I've seen a lot of destructive groups, as most of you have, and I don't want to go there. I don't want to set the stage. I think we set the stage, and I know we did a little acting out here, but it's like if you set the stage, the actors and the play, if you will, or the group, will come into more of a positive result at the end. So one of the things that I like to do at times is to get people on their feet and do scenarios. And we didn't do it that much here, but we did it. We at least touched on it. So again, being the Missouri kind of person that you might be, in terms of show me what might happen, what you might do, and let's run through three scenes. If you run through more than that, they run out of ideas usually. And then again, working with the power of the group, like Pamela might not know, so but Marlene might, and or Jose might, or Nate, or Brian, and so having them suggest things and show other behaviors, because again, I don't know, is the best form of resistance out there, and it doesn't really help anyone, and of course it doesn't help if you're doing it, but if their peers are helping out, I really look at the power of the group, and I really look at role plays and coping strategies that they might engage in. I think if I think the literature supports it more than not, that if you have people having a voice that they can hear themselves, and if they can participate in a non-threatening way on a question or something that you might ask, that they're much more likely to participate than to frustrate themselves and you by not doing anything. In happy days, the Fonz would say, sit on it, right? And some people sit on it in regard to they have feelings, but they don't feel like they can get their voice heard. So with a Brian over here who's wanting to be more assertive, I would think it would be especially important that he get some air time. And again, if you can get some air time, and if everybody's participated, then there's nobody that everyone's looking at as the identified in family therapy and the identified patient, as the outlier, as the outsider, as the person who really is either above or below it all. So I really do think it's one of the better skills we have in group work to make sure everyone gets a voice. And then they don't have to say anything after that, but at least they've participated in this regard. I think, again, the thing to do is to ask the group as you go around, have we finished everything? Is there something that we talked about last week that you'd like to work on, to clarify? And again, people may say, yes, there is. A lot of times, no. But that way, you're letting them know that you heard and what was happening last week, and you want to make sure that they're okay. There's nothing stronger than a broken gestalt. That is, people, if you haven't finished something, people are going to get it in there, regardless of whether you give them permission or not. I used to work in a mental health center, and I'd always give my clients permission to walk around because I knew many of them were going to do that, whether I gave them permission or not. It made me feel better. and it didn't make them feel any worse. But I'd start it with last week. It's summarizing. Last week we talked about this, again, I'm wondering if there's any unfinished business about that. It was somewhat spontaneous on my part, but let me tell you the rationale of why I did what I did. I thought that it was that what they were doing was a little too ambiguous, and so I wanted to make it more concrete. One of the things we do in counseling, group counseling and individual counseling, is we make the covert overt, and I wanted to make sure there was an overt display and an overt acceptance of what they were giving and receiving. And let me let them talk for themselves, Nathaniel and Brian.
Yeah, for me, it was very similar to what you're saying. I think I'll just piggyback on it. But it's easy to be ambiguous. It's easy to stay in kind of the abstract world. This took some mental juices. To think, okay, what exactly am I giving Brian, and what do I do with what Brian's giving me? How do I bring Brian out? Was part of the thing that started that, and that was harder work. and I may not have gone there without the prompt.
And I'll just speak to the change, trying to work on the change of increasing my confidence. It was good just to move in the group and change position in the group and to move over in that area and to work with Nate, giving gifts back and forth and having more explanation, having those encouragers, because I really didn't know what to give Nate. Mm-hmm. So that was very helpful in that position.
Yeah. I wanted them to be as specific as they could. And so many times, again, it's amorphous. In terms of what people are wanting to share, so trying to make it as concrete as we could so that they really had a takeaway. I was trying to see, and you couldn't see because you're in the back there, but I was trying to use my eyes to see what they were doing in terms of their behaviors, subtle or not, in terms of overtness. I considered them an entity, so I wasn't working individually just with Pamela, with Brian, Marlene, with Jose, with Nathaniel. The group was an entity. They were the client, if I can say it that way, which I just did. So I wanted to see that everyone came out with something, and the group came out with something. So it was a both and rather than an either or is another way to say that. But I wanted to, we talked earlier about negative group experiences. I wanted to make sure that this group was running in a smooth a manner as possible and as positive a manner as something as possible, and that the feeling that they left with and their takeaways was elevated and different than when they may have come in, because I think we were all a little nervous. Mm-hmm. We had not rehearsed this. And one of the best ways we learn how to be good group leaders and good group members, to be honest, is to see a group in action. And so our takeaways, vicarious learning, you know, social psych stuff, that how do you learn things? Well, modeling, seeing people do it and realizing I could do it this way, or I could do it that way, or I could do it another way. I'm a card-carrying member of the Associations for Specialists in Group Work, which is one of the divisions of the American Counseling Association. There's also some other good group behavior societies and other professional societies or associations, but I go to their workshops, ASGW's workshops, Association Specialist Group Work, as much as I can. I read the literature because they publish a journal, and I read other journals also. I look at videos of people who have run groups and do groups. Jerry Corey, Ed Jacobs, others. I'll just give a shout out to my colleagues. They're good. I actually write about groups, and if you get the book, Little Timmy Can Have the Operation, it's okay. I try to write about what's going on as well as to read about it. And I try to journal if I have led a group. I try to journal right after that, just like I'd take case notes in individual work. I'll do a journal about the group as a whole and any outstanding parts or people within it. We've come to the end of our time today, and I want to thank you for being here and being such a great audience. I hope you're going away with some things that you can learn and employ in groups that you lead. I will be around, as will members of this group, if you want to talk with them even more. And thank you again for being here.